morning. Our next speaker is Bert Wagner, and he will be talking to us today about cross-server data joins on slow networks with Python.
All right, awesome. Well, welcome everyone. Hope you're having a good morning so far. I'd like to start off today's talk talking about my relationship. Probably many of you have had similar relationships with data and networks in the past. I'm going to kind of do it through the decades. And so kind of the first one I want to talk about is what I call the mom don't use the phone era of my upbringing. I hear the laughter, which is good. Obviously, this is talking about the days of dial-up, right, where our network data transfer speeds were very important, right? And I'd be talking to friends, and if someone picked up that phone, it was a very binary decision. It went from sending data to not sending data, and even though that data was really small, right, text chat, it made a big difference. You had to be cognizant of that. Also, it was a time of free music. I don't know if many people know that. You have to pay for music now, but it used to be free. And that used to be really important to think about with your dial-up connection. So you'd be waiting an hour to download a song, and you'd find out eventually that it was mislabeled or whatever. But you'd want that song to download, and so making sure you're not abusing your bandwidth so that you can focus on the download was really important. The web at the time also had lots of interesting things to look at. That's what made the web great. So for what little bandwidth and speed I had, I wanted to spend it on fun things like that. That era of the web, I had lots of fan sites for a band or hobby or whatever we can go check out. Your favorite images, if they ever decided to load, they'd be really slow. Bandwidth, whether I was thinking about it or not, was a really important part of my life, even back then during the dial-up days. Sorry, Joey, we're not going to wait for you to load. All right, so fast forward a decade, we've upgraded to like DSL, cable modems, internet's a lot faster, things are a lot better. Websites are in this perfect phase where they have good content, they're interesting, but they're not like bloated single-page JavaScript applications. They don't have all this privacy tracking junk embedded in them that are slowing things down. The web was nice. It had a lot of bandwidth. Things were fast. Websites were good. Our media consumption, our gaming, was pretty good for all the security flaws, like Macromedia Flash. They made for really great games. But didn't really need a lot of networking processing power in the background to get them to work. And then, be remiss if I don't mention, the early days of YouTube, where you can go stream 240p video on a DSL connection, it'd be fine. It'd be totally fine. And this is why I kind of think of this as the golden era. But unfortunately, history repeats itself, and now we're back to this era, which I like to call the stop streaming era. I'm sure many of you can guess, but nowadays we work from home, maybe we've got something on in the background, a lot of streaming services, you have kids, family members, they may be watching TV. Suddenly our bandwidth is becoming a lot more precious. We're all on video calls, especially if we're working from home. We maybe have spouses or other people in the house who are on video calls. Once again, more bandwidth used up for things that maybe aren't that important to us. Gaming bandwidth now has become much more important, right? Latency is a huge deal. So I want to make sure my home network is as good as possible to be able to give myself that competitive advantage. Or maybe I don't, and then I just blame how bad I am at games on my internet connection. That's fine, too. We just had, if you were in this room before here, was a home automation talk. But I can't even turn a light bulb on without having the Wi-Fi working in my house. Right? This has become such an integral thing that now to turn on a light, I have to think about the network capacity in my house. But finally, the reason why we're all here today, it's probably because we need it to do our jobs and do the fun things we like doing. We like to program, probably like to use data that's not on our local laptops, on our local computers at home. Maybe we're connecting to like a corporate network and dealing with data. Maybe we're connecting to cloud, third-party vendors. wherever, right? Data is an important part of the things we do, and being able to work with that data when it's having to compete for network resources with all these other things, right, isn't always easy. And so my goal for this talk is hopefully we all walk away today being a little bit more cognizant about how our data is traversing our network and what we can do about it to make things faster. So my name is Bert Wagner. I'm a data scientist by day. I also like to blog and make YouTube videos about data performance concepts. So if you're into that, check that out. I've already uploaded these slides on my GitHub. I've created a quick link there. Feel free to take a look at them afterwards if you want, or if you have follow-up questions after this session. But today's agenda, we're going to be talking about how do we join datasets across networks efficiently, across networks that maybe are bloated by all those streaming apps and everything else. And I'm going to share three solutions, right? It's only going to be three. We're not going to get into much detail. Right, we've got 25 minutes left here. There's not that much time. But we'll start with kind of the great solutions I want to be using 90%+ of the time, or can use 90% of the time. We'll get to the not bad solutions, but you'll see there's some downsides. And then we'll end with the ugly solutions, which are the ones that you hope you never have to use, but they're good to have in kind of a pocket knife, utility knife, right in your back pocket for when the situation arises where you do need them. Let's talk about a scenario, right? We have these two data sets. Take this example, right? We have a CSV file. Let's think of it. It's got some customers in it, and it doesn't have all of the columns of data that we maybe want with our customers. We need some additional attributes, because we're going to be doing whatever, some modeling or whatever else with it. The rest of those customer attributes are in, let's say, a data warehouse, some kind of relational database. I have it denoted with a little cloud. It could be in the cloud, or it could be just in a data center owned by our company or whatever. And our goal here is, right, we want to join these two data sets together. The CSV file, maybe 100,000 rows, 2 gigs in size on my local laptop, and, let's say 30 million rows, 20 gigs of data in a database somewhere not local to my laptop. So does anyone have any, what's everyone's go-to method for this? Shout it out. Select star. All right, well, we'll talk about that. What? Reloaded into the data center. I like that. You know, at a networking talk, we're talking about moving data to the data center. Well, so let's jump to that. That's actually my favorite solution, right? This is the one you want to use if you can. And so the way it kind of looks is we take our CSV file of data, customer data, and we move that across the network, right? That's our smallest kind of piece of data that we're working with. Let's move that to our data center or to the cloud or wherever the bigger data is, right? This kind of technique is called moving your smaller data to where the bigger data lives. And so maybe that means we're going to create like a staging table in our, if it's a database or something like that, maybe we can create like a temporary in-memory table. It's kind of up to you how you do it, right? But you create that, and then you do your join, right? And relational databases, whatever flavor you choose to use, they're really good at doing set-based operations. They're really good at doing joins, right? So you're going to be using the right tool for the job in that case. You're going to be able to join that data, especially if you index it and everything else. You're going to get really great performance out of that. Once that's done, you can output your data. So here in this example, I'm doing some inner join. I'm losing some records, right? So only outputting 80,000 rows once again. That travels back across the network to our laptops or wherever. And then we can go ahead and process that data, transform it, do whatever we want with it. But at that point, right, we're not working with this big massive set. We're just working with kind of our final subset. And now this solution, there's a lot of things I like about it, right? First of all, you're moving your smaller data to where the larger data lives. You're really minimizing how much network traffic you're going to be having, and that's awesome. It's also, I'm going to assume here that your database is on some kind of server with some, better specs than what your laptop would have. You're going to be able to process that data well. You're using the right tool for the job. That's going to be a really good thing. Additionally, let's see. The one thing that this solution is not great at is the fact that if you need to clean and transform your data right before you do your join, it's going to be a little tough. Like, sure, you can do, you know, some replace functions in your database if you need to clean some data up, but that's not really the right place to do it. Databases aren't necessarily the best tool to use for that kind of job. So as an example, maybe to make it more concrete, imagine we're joining these two customer databases up based on their street address. And maybe one of the files, we got 123 Main Street, fully spelled out. And then the other file, we got 123 Main ST, right, an abbreviated form of street. You're not going to be able to join on those columns on their own. You're going to have to do a little bit of cleanup on them to kind of do a lookup, make a match, something like that. And so in this scenario, that can sometimes get tricky. It's not always the best place to be able to do that. So we have other options. Before we get to them, though, I just want to remind everyone of kind of the goal of this session, right? Think about where your data is moving. In this case, let's say here we are in Salt Lake City, and I'm moving that 2 gigabyte file to a corporate VPN endpoint, maybe somewhere in Los Angeles. It's going out to the East Coast in Virginia to some cloud provider. Maybe that's where all my data processing is happening. Great. When that data comes back, it's a small subset, right? It has to make all those hops back, not to mention all the hops in between. So just think about that when you're kind of working with data, with large data sets. Think about how much network traversal is having to happen in order for this, you know, to be effective. So just to summarize this, right, this kind of moving the small data to where your big data lives, minimizes network movement, it maximizes, you know, the tools for what they're good for. The downsides are you need to be able to write your data to that kind of larger database. So maybe a database administrator could really lock the database down. You're not allowed to create additional tables on it. It could be problematic. If you're working with a vendor database that's read-only, it's going to be a little bit more challenging. And also, this isn't the greatest solution if you have to do a lot of transformation. I've talked a lot about this topic in the past in way more detail than 30 minutes can handle. So if you're interested in that, I've linked to some other conference talks I've had for additional tips of kind of making that process a lot more speedy. But we will, for now, continue to the next topic. So these are not bad solutions. In this case, we are assuming we have a big heavy-duty server in the middle there that's going to help us do our joins, right? So we have our small data set in the bottom left. We've got our, you know, database with our large amount of data on the right. We can't move our small data to our large data. So what are we going to do? We are going to do this join on some big heavy-duty application server, right? With hundreds of gigs of memory, dozens of CPUs, it's going to be able to handle it. And this is traditionally what you maybe would see in like an ETL pipeline solution. You know, it's great. It gets the job done. You need to, you know, be able to have a server and procure it. For some of us, right, it's pretty easy. Spin up some instance in the cloud, you're ready to go. For other of us, others, there's, you know, lots of corporate red tape maybe to get that server. So it's kind of choose your own adventure of how easy or hard that is. Thinking about network traversal again, we are going to have to move that giant database, you know, 30 gigs or whatever I said it was. So it would be beneficial to still have this big heavy-duty server as close to your database server as possible, right? So maybe that's in a corporate data center. They're in the same place. They're going to be moving across fiber or something. It'll be really fast. Won't be a big deal. You know, if your big heavy-duty server is in your basement, because you have one of those because you're a nerd like me, that's awesome, but it's going to be really slow competing with all the Netflix bandwidth and everything else having to move to your house. So that's a big caveat of this, that you need to have that data there. Another plus of this solution, though, is if we have that situation again where we need to do our join, we have our street address data, and it's not exactly lining up, right? 123 Main Street spelled out versus an abbreviated street in our other data set. We can process that data really easily, really nicely with something like Python here before we do our joins. so that's really cool. And if we're doing our joins, you know, for a lot of us, it might be using something like Pandas. Having just plenty of memory and disk space available to do that join is just a really nice option. You could also, in this scenario, and there's plenty of other Python packages out there, so if you use something like, I like using Dask sometimes, so Dask will allow you to parallelize it and kind of distribute some computations to across lots of machines. So once again, if you have more than one machine available to kind of do this data processing, great. That's a great place to be. But obviously, not everyone will have that available to them, so I don't want to focus too much on that. So, right, let's summarize the solution. If the large data is on the same network, right, as our application servers, where we're maybe running Python to do some joins, performance is going to be pretty good. Getting cool machines, even better. There's lots of packages out there that you could utilize to make that work. If you've never checked out, there's a good documentation page in the Pandas documentation. I'll include a link to it down below, where they talk about all different kind of packages for that are better dealing with large data sets than maybe Pandas itself. So depending on your individual use case, there may be a better option there. You know, the downsides here are, obviously, servers are hard to get sometimes. And like we said, we got to be on the same network. So, let's see. Any quick questions before we continue on and we get to the ugly solutions? So these two solutions, this is what you want to be doing when you're dealing with data. All right. Great. We'll have maybe a little time for questions at the end then. All right. So, let's get to the ugly solution. We're going to write our own hash join. So for those of you with kind of maybe some computer science degrees, this may be a little familiar. If that's not your background, totally cool. Wasn't my background either. I have a degree in political science. but it doesn't mean you can't enjoy a little theory. If it goes over your head, don't worry about it. You don't need to know it all to kind of be able to use the Python code that I include at the end. So, what we want to do with this hash join, right, at a high level, we've got our two data sets, right, represented by these two columns of colorful data. We have our build input data set, so that would be our smaller data set, and we have our probe input data set, that's going to be our large data set. And the way a hash join works, this is how a lot of the relational databases kind of implement this, and a lot of other tools too. We're just going to be running it with all the control that we want, in order to kind of make things reliable. So what happens is we take our data. Here we're going to take data B. We're going to run it through a hash function, and it's going to go get stored in a hash bucket or a dictionary. We're doing this hashing. We're using this hash function on the columns that we're going to be using in our join, right? And so we're hashing that data to be able to quickly look it up and see if there's any matches in a minute, which we'll see. So we have to do that for all our data, right? So we take the next row of data, we hash the columns that we're joining on, put that in its own bucket, do that again for the next data, and we keep doing that. Now, the interesting thing with hash functions is, you'll see here, we got two pieces of data that fell into the same bucket. So in the implementation I'm going to show you in a minute, I'm using Python's hash method, which is, I believe, using sit hash under the covers, which is collision resistant, but not collision-proof. And so what that means is, what a collision when it comes to hashes, what that means is you take two very different inputs, and you pass them through the hash function, and they end up outputting the same exact value. That's what's known as a collision. We need to check for those, so this is kind of an example here of a collision happening, even though A and F are two different pieces of data, they're generating the same hash, and they're getting put in the same hash bucket. So something to be aware of, but we'll need to check for that in a minute and finally do that with our last piece of data there. Now, all of this data that's in our hash bucket that was kind of in our build input phase needs to fit into memory. So if you are running this on a lower performance laptop, whatever, you got to be able to store that in memory. There are workarounds, write stuff to disk, page it up this, bring it up into buffer if you want to. That's way beyond, this tutorial and the packet that we're going to be showing you. Just assume your small data set can fit in memory. And what that's going to enable you to do is now stream all of the rest of your data across the network to kind of compare it and see if we have a match, right? So we stream that in from our SQL database, our giant SQL database, we hash it. It gets put in a hash bucket. Now we can see, oh, cool, these both have a hash value of 2. Let's actually now iterate over them and check to see if they're a match. Cool, these values actually match. Not just the hashes, but the values of our join keys match. And we're doing that once again because in this case, there was a collision, so it didn't match with F. That's why we got to check the values one by one. And so we do this again for the next row of data. We pass that in, we check to see if there are matches, we iterate, and right, we save our matches off. Maybe we save them for our local hard drive, maybe we save them somewhere else. And we kind of repeat this process for all the rest of our data. Now, the cool thing with this is that if we get a network error, right, or our network blows up and we have to restart it, as long as we can go look at our output file and see kind of what our last match record was, we can re-query our database, our large data set input, and have it kind of resume from where it left off. So that's the really nice thing about this. This is a slow solution. So thinking about, again, like network movement, we are streaming that gigantic database to our laptop, but it is very reliable. If that thing crashes, you can have some try, accept, logic to say, hey, pick up where I left off. Which is really nice, right? If you get stuck in that scenario where you have to do that, it's really nice to be able to do that. So, how do we actually implement this in practice? We're done with the theory. So, I built a package for it because I couldn't find anyone else who had done it. It's called CrossStream, so you can install that. Two S's, and if you just search for my name on GitHub or whatever, you can find it that way too. Makes it really easy to use, so let's kind of look through one example, because I've spent a lot of time with coworkers and just on my own having to solve this problem when we get these kind of weird data sets that we can't easily move data around. We have to kind of do things this way, and we don't want them to die prematurely. We need to join the finish. So starting out at the top, pretty basic, import the package. We're going to create we're going to read in our files. So here I'm using 2 CSV files in the demo, but the package will allow you to do an ODBC connection as well, so you can go straight from a database or anything else that you can connect to with an ODBC driver. So that works pretty well. And this is just going to kind of do a lazy read. All we're doing here, this is similar to how packages like Dashboard, right? We're just kind of getting metadata in about our data sets, right? So what are the files? Do they contain header columns? And what are the columns that we're going to be joining on between our two data sets? We're just kind of telling the program that's all the info we need. Then we kind of get our output file set up, right? So maybe it's local, maybe it's on network attached storage. We write out some header columns, and this is all just dealing with CSVs to keep things simple. And then we finally, right, this is kind of what we just looked at on that last slide with 60 animations on it. This is doing that inner hash join. And so it loads that first file into memory, the small one, and then it's going to stream one row at a time from your other large data source, every single record, do the hashing, do the joins, and, eventually get your data to work in an unreliable network environment. And that's where I said you can wrap this up in like a try accept and do some error handling logic if you think you're going to have problems with this finishing out. A couple other things I want to show here is, we were talking about, hey, if you have a street address where you have to convert 123 Main Street spelled out 123 Main, ST with an abbreviation, how do we do that? Well, this solution actually works really well. I'm trying to minimize, having only one row of data in memory at a time from the streaming side, from the probing side. And so what's in here is there's a function you can override that describes how you want to transform your data before you join it. So if you just create a simple function where you pass in the value of one of your columns that you're joining on, and you tell it how you want to transform it, right? So here we're just doing a basic, you know, strip out the white space kind of transformation, but you can make this as complicated as you want, right? There's no limit to how complicated you want to solve it, maybe slowing down your process. But you can do, you know, you could do these different kind of geospatial stuff. There's some complicated transformations you may need to do before you join your data. It could be things like street addresses for fuzzy matching. Whatever you need, right, you can kind of take care of that. And then so when you call your inner hash join function, you just pass in as a named argument there the name of your function that you created with your kind of custom join transformation logic. So that'll just kind of do it as the data streaming through. And so finally, the last thing I kind of want to point out with this solution is just how we can transform data before we do our join. There's also the capability to transform your data after your join happens. And figure, oh, well, for performance, that row of data is already in memory. This would be the perfect time to do something with it if we needed it to, right? Just to kind of get things to go quicker, so we don't have to save the disk and then read it in later. So this works very similarly. You can create your own, you know, function for kind of how to process the data once it's matched. Here, right, I'm just adding a static, you know, weight value of 1.0 to every single row, and then so we're returning that row of data there as those tuples. And then so in our inner join function that we were calling, we can pass in that custom, you know, custom processing function as an override. Right? And so in conclusion, this ugly solution, even though it's not going to be as fast as our other two options, and it's not as good as our other two options, it is reliable. It is a reliable way to get this kind of problem of joining data sets across networks to work if you need to. It has a lot of retryability. You can program that in and increase the network failure, and it's really flexible and customizable in terms of if you need to be able to do data transformation in order to get your joins to work. I try to be pretty good about reading in data only once and kind of keeping memory usage as low as possible. In my use case of when I created this, right, it was I only had my laptop and it was like, you know, whatever, 10 gigs of free RAM and like no disk space available. Sometimes that's the world we have to work with. So if that sounds like a problem you have, right, then check that out. But with that said, thank you very much. And I think we've got 2 minutes if people have questions.
Are there ways in the library to optimize the hash function?
Great question. No. I was, you know, just trying to get the basics working because I was at the story behind this is we were at a deadline. I needed to get this join to work, and nothing else was working. So this was the first pass kind of take at it. So there's no, you know, huge crazy optimizations. It was more focusing on the reliability aspect of it. Thank you, though. All right. Well, I want to make sure we have enough time for the next speaker. If anyone else has questions, I'll be hanging around in the back or outside. But thank you for coming.